Hey everybody, thanks for watching this video. My name's Zach Peterson, I'm a technical consultant with Altium, and today we're gonna continue our discussion about mixed signal PCB design. In the last couple of videos, we talked a lot about grounding, tracking return paths, and how to prevent interference between your signals, and especially what not to do when defining ground in your mixed signal PCB. Now, mixed signal PCBs can be kind of complex, and with this whole goal of preventing interference between your analog and digital sections, where do you put everything on the board? That's always one of those things that comes up with a lot of designs, especially when designs get really dense and there aren't always clearly defined circuit blocks. But with mixed signal designs, it's really important because you want to prevent your analog signals and your digital signals from interfering however you possibly can. One way to do this is to look at some examples and consider some different type of analog interfaces you might have to deal with, as well as the different digital components that you are likely to find on a mixed signal board, and develop some strategies for how to lay out things generally. So I'll get into some examples. Let's get started. So a good place to start, as with high density digital systems or high speed digital systems, is your main processor, usually an MCU, maybe less commonly an FPGA. That's usually where I start. That's where the layout folks that work for me generally start. Where are we gonna put that? So it's a good idea to have it more or less centrally located, and I'm just gonna call this our MCU. So this is our microcontroller unit. So the reason I want to put it here is because this is usually a component that has pins on all four sides. It's going to have to connect the stuff this direction, side to side, all around it. And if you start thinking about it like that, it's easier to start orienting other stuff around the MCU so that you can actually connect to it and get signals into your MCU for further processing. Generally, what you'll have is you'll have a couple of pins on one side that are going to be dedicated for an ADC, or an analog to digital converter. And that's going to dictate where you're then going to put your analog interface on the board. So let's say we have our ADC input over here. This is for our ADC. Then I'm going to want to put my analog circuitry, let's just say, more or less in this area. The reason I bring this up is because it would be generally a good idea to try and keep any other circuitry, digital circuitry specifically, out of this area if possible. Now, you don't want to create crosstalk by putting digital signals too close to your analog signals. Those can then induce noise into your analog signals, and then that corrupts the analog signal you try and read out in the MCU. In a recent board that we did, we actually had a connector here that went over to an analog sensor that was off board. And so in this type of arrangement, you would have your ADC, I have some routing, and then I have my connector over here at the board edge. And then this connector would then connect over to, of course, your offboard analog sensor. You could have the analog sensor just located over here in this area if you really wanted to. When you're working with higher frequencies, generally what you'll see is something like via fences going along this type, this section of the board. So you might have some via fences going along this, this analog interconnect. The reason for this kind of goes both ways. You want to prevent the analog signal from inducing noise somewhere else, but you also want to prevent it from receiving noise. So by doing that, you're trying to provide some isolation. So by dedicating its own area of the board to it, and then trying to keep some other digital stuff away from it, you can provide enough isolation that you can ensure that this analog signal that you read out in your MCU is nice and clean. So then, where does all the other stuff go? One good strategy is maybe up here in this section, put your power input. So this might be from a bench power supply. This might be from a battery. It doesn't really matter how you get it onto the board. Just the point is, you get it onto the board somewhere, feed that into your power and ground plane, and your power plane is probably gonna run something like this. I call it a power plane. It's really just a power polygon that's gonna run over here and provide power to your MCU. Although if you've got other components around and they need power, you know, extend that power region out all over the board if you need to. So I'm just gonna erase this dotted line for now, because it could really go anywhere. Then you're generally gonna have some GPIOs or some other bus interfaces coming off of the MCU, and those need to go to your other components. If you have this type of system, you've got your analog section over here, It's generally a good idea to maybe put your digital stuff or your other digital stuff over here in this area. Let's say I've got I2C bus coming off of here. I can go from there and route that into this other area, and maybe that routes over to these other peripheral components. So not the cleanest drawing, but hopefully that kind of illustrates where it's a good idea to put things. So some MCUs also have maybe a higher frequency wireless interface or a higher frequency RF interface that is used to maybe route to a Wi-Fi antenna or Bluetooth antenna. And in some cases, that antenna is actually built onto the module. TI has a line of processors that does this. NRF52 is another line of processors that does this. If you look online, look up like Wi-Fi MCU or Bluetooth MCU, you'll actually find a lot of examples. In the case where you have an MCU with maybe like a Wi-Fi output that can route to an external antenna, you also want to be careful here because you want to make sure that you're putting that antenna somewhere on the board where you're not routing that high frequency output too close to your other digital components. Vice versa, you don't want to put your digital components too close to that particular RF output. Generally what you'll see is an antenna connector over here. So maybe it's an off-board antenna. And you'd have like a UFL connector over here in the corner. And this can connect to an external antenna, and then you would want to route over here with something like this. So this is just an example. It could be a printed antenna, and maybe the antenna just is printed directly on the board and you route to it directly. And so the whole point of doing this type of layout and segmenting is, again, we want to keep our analog stuff with the analog stuff. We want to keep the digital stuff with the digital stuff. And by doing that, we're gonna have a lot easier time of making sure that there's isolation between everything. With this Wi-Fi section, a good idea is to do a coplanar routing here. Coplanar waveguide routing provides high isolation between this section of the interconnect and other stuff in the board. So by doing coplanar waveguide routing, what you're actually doing is you're filling in a lot of ground around that. So I know this isn't the best drawing, but what I'll do is I'll actually show an example here in just a moment. Now with coplanar routing, this has a nice defined impedance, stays nice and isolated from other stuff in the system. You've got ground around it. Everything's good.
So what I'm showing here is just a little bit of a layout for a mixed signal board. And hopefully this will kind of show some strategies for arranging components over your ground plane, and then how to route high frequency lines versus your DC. So first, let me zoom out and just point out that this is a board that's still in progress. So there's, you know, obviously some clearance constraints up here that are that need to be cleared up. There's some routing here that I need to finish and a couple of components that need to be placed along these feed lines. But the important point here is that here we have a coplanar waveguide, and it's got a lot of vias along the edge for isolation. This is something that you might do in like a board that's going to carry a really high power RF. This particular board with this long feed line section and this feed line section going vertically is operating in the ISM band. So it's operating at 2.4 gigahertz. Now, if I zoom in here, you can see, you know, we've got this nice bend, and then it splits off here going to this component right here. So number 17 ground pad, this is a filter component, and then coming up here up north to an SMA connector, and then this is where I have some clearance constraints I need to clear out. The important point here is that the way this is laid out is I've actually got my DC way down here. So my DC comes in, it goes to some components for regulation, and then it comes out to the main components over here on the left side of the board. And so all of the RF stuff is kept over here on the left side and then routes around the edge of the board. This is kind of a long route. Well, at least it looks like kind of a long route until you consider that the size of the board, at least horizontally, is only 3 inches, and it's just about 2.5 inches vertically. So it's actually a pretty small board. And you can get away with this type of routing at not too high gigahertz frequencies in the ISM band is where I'm at, and you could probably do the same on FR4. And you'll actually find some evaluation products from semiconductor companies that route over similar distances on an FR4 laminate at similar frequencies, so typically Wi-Fi or Bluetooth frequencies. So there's not a ton of loss. If this were something that we were doing for like a 24 gigahertz radar, you would definitely not want to do these long routes. And it's not because of necessarily a problem with noise or anything in the mixed signal system. It would mostly be because of losses. I mean, you could have noise problems, but these long routes, when you have these long routes, losses are much more important. And so the way this is laid out is, you know, I've put all of the RF stuff going along this edge. So it's nice and kept away from some of the core digital stuff, which is over here in this area, and then also from the DC stuff, which is down here. And then the other important point here in this board, just look at layer two, it's a ground plane. It's entirely ground. Everything on layer two is ground. And then I've got my power sections. And then here on the bottom layer, there's some additional routing that I still need to clean up. I had some components here previously. So this all still needs to be cleaned up. However, this is all grounded poor, and then you can just put some other miscellaneous routes on the bottom layer as well. So hopefully that kind of illustrates a good way to try and separate things in this type of system. The main point here is that once I get up to my really high frequency stuff, I've kept it in its own region of the board, away from a lot of the other stuff that's in the board that would be running at that would be running digitally, or that would be running at DC down here. Here's my DC section, and then the point of all of these vias along these lines. So I can just select them. The point of all of these vias here along these lines is to provide isolation for the RF signal that's being carried by these long feed lines. And that's one trick that's used in coplanar routing to provide some isolation between this section and then all of this stuff down here. And then if you just zoom in, you'll see all of these vias are all set to the ground net. And so you're just routing these vias directly through the top layer. This top polygon is grounded right through to the very next layer, which is also ground. And so you get this nice wraparound of ground around this line. And that's what's providing isolation all the way throughout that interconnect.
I had drawn my Wi-Fi section in here, you know, kind of like this, which is one way to do it. And this was like a UFL. This could also be an SMA connector, so maybe it's connecting to a rubber ducky antenna or some other type of antenna that just goes off board. You could also just have this be like a printed antenna. So maybe this is like a inverted F antenna, or it's some other type of printed style antenna. Doesn't really matter. The point here is that we've got everything separated, and when we think about our mixed signal layout, we're not putting the printed antenna over here really close to these digital circuits, or we're not putting our ADC interface all the way over here. This interface here for the analog sensor that I drew in this layout, we wouldn't want to put it over here for a couple of reasons. First, we're putting it close to a bunch of digital stuff, and there's that danger that those digital signals create crosstalk, and that degrades our analog signal that we want to read out with the ADC. The second reason is that you just have to route it all the way over here. Like, there's no point. So just be careful where you place components. Think about where the pinout is, or all the pins are on your MCU. Think about where your interfaces are so that you can place digital signals around that. This is as much about keeping the layout nice and compact, easy to route, as it is about preventing interference between different types of signals. In this example, like with my printed antenna, my return path is gonna be, you know, largely in this kind of region around the trace. Same thing with my my analog sensor here. My return path is gonna be, you know, pretty closely confined around here. For my digital signals, the return path is gonna be pretty closely confined around these digital connections. I don't have to worry about anything like, say, putting a big split in my ground plane right here. There's just no point. If you're careful about how you lay things out and how you route things, you don't need to worry about doing stuff like splitting up your ground plane. And that's still, to this day, you'll see a lot of online design guidelines that say to keep splitting up the ground plane. Don't do it. So the biggest takeaway from all this that you can get is this. First, there's no need to split up the ground plane if you lay everything out correctly. So just don't do it. Second, think about where you're routing, because even if you do have a uniform ground plane, and you have to do all these weird routes all over the board, you create new opportunities for signals to interfere with each other. Think about where everything is on your processor. Think about where your interfaces are. Put components there. Don't put them anywhere else. So I hope you all like this video. Please help us hack that YouTube algorithm. Hit the like button, hit the subscribe button, leave a comment, click on the links in the description. We've got some good info for you. So if you like what you saw in the earlier example with Coplanar waveguide routing, go check out Altium Designer. You can sign up for a free trial. You'll get access to the industry's best layout and routing tools, and you'll have tools that you need to instantly generate fabrication and assembly data for your manufacturer. Super easy to use, super easy to get started. If you've never used Altium Designer, go give it a try today. Thanks everyone for watching, and I'll see you next time.